Hello, I'm Sim with the OSINT Dojo. In this video, we're going to discuss part one of my OSINT methodology for emails. Emails are another one of those common identifiers most investigators run across during an online investigation. When beginning an investigation into an email, there are certain processes that I follow just to ensure I've extracted as much information as possible. In order to properly frame my investigation, I split this methodology up into two distinct sections. One part that focuses on the content analysis of the email itself, another one that focuses on the different email-related tools and searches. For this video, we are solely going to focus on the content analysis portion of my email methodology. Now, before doing any exploitation of the email or running it through any specialized queries, I first break down the email into three distinct parts: the username, the second-level domain, and the top-level domain. We're going to go through each of these sections individually and highlight what additional information we may be able to glean from each of them. So first up, we have the username portion of the email. This is going to be the first part of the email right before the at sign. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time going over the content analysis for the username portion of an email, as I already have a full video dedicated to username content analysis. However, I do want to mention that in most cases, the username is the portion of an email address which the target will have the most influence over, and therefore is the section most likely to contain some very good clues regarding their identity. For this reason, be sure to keep an eye out for any information that might give a clue to your target's location, age, group affiliation, etc. Another thing to look out for is the presence of a first name or a surname in this section. In my personal experience, more people will use some portion of their real-world identity in their email address, even if they're careful not to include their real name in any of their actual usernames. Now next up, we have second-level domains, which are between the at symbol and the top-level domain of an email address. Something like the generic Gmail or ProtonMail second-level domains aren't going to provide much information on their own. But for second-level domains that don't belong to one of these more common free email providers, there might be additional information that can be obtained. For example, a target using an email from their service provider not only lets you know who may supply their connection, but depending on the ISP's footprint, it might also provide some geolocation clues, assuming the ISP only offers their services to a specific country, town, or region. You also want to keep an eye out for second-level domains that are specific to a company or an employer. This may help narrow down a target's other online accounts, should they have a more common name, or perhaps give some insight into the type of work that they might be involved in. One thing to keep in mind regarding employer emails is that unlike personal emails, the target may only have access to them during a very small window of time, so they're not always great leads for more current information. That being said, employer emails are much more likely to include the target's real name compared to personal emails. Some second-level domains might also give insight into what devices or other platforms a user might utilize. For example, an iCloud email would suggest that the target has at least one Apple device. And while it's not a guarantee, there is a possibility that the target with a Gmail address might either have an Android device or perhaps a YouTube account associated with that email. And finally, emails with some second-level domains are heavily favored by citizens of specific countries or speakers of a specific language. For example, Yandex is quite popular with Russian users, while Tencent emails are much more common for Chinese internet users. Now, you'll want to use other information to corroborate these assumptions, but at the very least, they do provide you with a very good starting point. And finally, we have top-level domains, or TLDs. This is going to be the portion at the very end of the email address. In addition to the generic TLDs like .com, there are some TLDs which may provide some supplemental information that we can leverage in our investigations. One such example are country TLDs. Now, although country-specific TLDs are not restricted solely to users that are located in that specific country, there are some free email providers that do use these country TLDs in such a manner for users from different countries. This may provide some clues to target's country location and or possibly one or more of the languages that they may speak. There are also some city TLDs, which might help narrow down the location of your target even further. While many of these city TLDs are open for purchase by anyone in the world, there are some, such as NYC and .melbourne, that do have restrictions that allow them to only be purchased by those who either live in or have a professional presence in those specific cities. Finally, there are also organizational-specific TLDs that might assist in determining a target's employer or their field of work. A target's association with a TLD like a .gov or .mil should be rather obvious, though a .edu might be a little bit more ambiguous, as they could be either an employee of the school or a current or past student. And so, now that we've mapped out all the information from an email's different sections, we can move on to the next phase of the email methodology, which will cover different email-related tools and searches.